الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره نستعين به سبحانه وتعالى ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا عباد الله أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله وأحثكم وإياها على طاعته وأحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولا شيء مثله ولا شيء قبله ولا شيء معه قديم بلا ابتداء دائم بلا انتهاء لا يفنى ولا يبيد ولا يكون إلا ما يريد لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام ولا يشبه الأنام حي لا يموت قيوم لا ينام سبحانه لا مثل له ولا مثال له ولا مثيل له ولا مماثل له ذلك بأن ربنا جل وعلا موصوف بصفات الوحدانية منعوت بنعوت الفردانية ليس في معناه أحد من البرية وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا وسيدنا ونور أبصارنا وبصائرنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك وجدد وضاعف وعظم ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن صحابته الغر الميامين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين أما بعد عباد الله يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن أعرض عن ذكري فإن له معيشة ضنكا ونحشره يوم القيامة أعمى قال ربي لما حشرتني أعمى وقد كنت بصيرا قال كذلك أتتك آياتنا فنسيتها وكذلك اليوم تنسى صدق الله العظيم. The ayahs are known, they're in Surah Taha. And the ayahs based the general concept of the ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in this ayah, says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي Whoever avoids my dhikr, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ Then he shall have a rough or tough life. ضَنَك, ضِيق, means narrow. Having narrow life. We'll talk about the meanings, etc. But now just a general concept. Not only that, وَنَحْشُرْهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى In the day of judgment, he or she will be assembled blind. We will see whether this is physical blindness or eye blindness, etc. قَالَ رَبِّي The ayah continues. Now, this ayah takes us into a scene in the day of judgment. This scene is the judgment of Allah and the sinful man. Sinful man means here no gender, man or woman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has judged in the ayah basically, which means if you avoid my dhikr, if you do not do my dhikr, then you will have a rough and narrow life, kind of lifestyle. And you will be assembled blind. In the day of judgment, this person will say, قَالَ رَبِّي He says or she says, رَبِّي لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى Why am I assembled blind? وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا I used to have my vision in the dunya. Why am I assembled blind now? The answer comes as كذلك. قَالَ كَذَلِك It shall be as such. أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا Our ayahs came to you and you have rejected them. So you shall be forgotten today. Let's go a little bit away from the ayahs and we'll come back to them. You can hardly pick a newspaper today, or watch a TV program, or read anything, any article, or talk to people in general, without hearing something about stress and anxiety. People are stressed everywhere. Workshop, I'm stressed. People are anxious. There's these two things, you see them, anxiety and stress. In the work, there's anxiety and stress. In the house, there's anxiety and stress. In the even the finances, anxiety and stress. Spirituality, anxiety and stress. Salah, anxiety and stress. Siyam, anxiety and stress. You see some people sometimes, when they are praying and reciting the Fatiha, as if there's someone behind them with a machine gun. If you slow down, I will kill you. There's nobody behind you. When you are praying, you are in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is this anxiety and stress in society has gotten so far that it is following, chasing people in their prayers? Yeah, especially the last part of tashahhud. Defeats the purpose. Notice. And now when we go to medically speaking, many of you are intellectuals and scholars and medical scientists, among others. You know that when anxiety and stress takes place in a human being, it distorts its productivity. And it diminishes the productivity and the return of that individual. Every individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you and gave you all you need to be the most successful person. Subhanallah. Everything you have. You have, every human being is born with all the ingredients for success. Period. ونفسين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I always say, when they talk about nafsiyat or the science, if we want to call it science, psychology, because being now psychology is, as there's still controversy whether it's a science or it's a set of theories. But anyway, psychology, when they talk about psychology and the science of the self, Al Quran talks about the nafs, nafsiyat. Go back to the Quran. Why do we go to Freud? And why do we go to Erickson? And why do we go to all these behaviorists? I'm not saying Islam respects everybody with their knowledge. And Islam wants you to be knowledgeable in these fields. Because the success in the Akhirah also means the success in the dunya. And many times we say, or there's a misconception that success in the Akhirah has nothing to do with the dunya. No, actually it's entirely connected. And therefore you look at the Sahaba al-Kiram radiyallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum, they were successful in the dunya and they are successful in the Akhirah. While when there is no success in the dunya, there is no success in the Akhirah. Because the success then is following the book of Allah and the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Okay. And when they did that, they were the leaders in sciences, they were the leaders in algebra, they were the leaders in this, and they were also the leaders in ad-deen. And now you see, not here, and then we're having troubles in both sides of the ayah. Okay. So this fact that when we talk about nafsiyat, when we talk about the nafs and the ulum of nafs and the sciences of nafs, Al-Quran al-Kareem tells you all these things. How many ayahs in the Quran talks about the nafs? وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ لَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي. Look at this, how many times you want nafs? All these, all these sciences, but people abandon these things and they go to what Freud says. Subhanallah. Okay, fine. Because all these things are theories. People, brothers and sisters, you all know that. Because again, of all your intellectual backgrounds, you know that these things are only hypotheses. And hypotheses are theories yet to be proven. Let's not take them as facts yet. Let's debate them when people say things. Okay. Al-Quran says, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. Allah created this nafs and equipped this nafs with everything it needs to be the best and to be the worst. To be the best and to be the worst. فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. What is the key then? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. If you do tazkiyah to your nafs, zakkaha again. Now for the past three khutbas we're talking about the word zakah. Not because I won't ask you any of your money. I'm not going to ask you any penny. And Islam doesn't want you to have but rich pockets. Anyway, we want you to be all rich. But Islam doesn't want you to have money in your heart. Islam wants you to have money in the pocket. There's difference. Money in the pocket is a good thing. Money in the heart is a bad thing. Right. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He who does tazkiyah or she who does tazkiyah to the nafs, then they will become successful. Subhanallah. How? What does zakah again mean? Zakah means growth. So if you develop your nafs so it grows, you will be it will grow and grow and grow until you become among the successfuls. Al-Hadith al-Sahih, the authentic hadith in Bukhari, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that among the signs of the believer is honesty, truthfulness, as-sidq. وَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَصْدُقُ. And the slave will keep saying the truth حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ صِدِّيقًا. Until he will be written in his books, he is صِدِّيق, which means the truthful. Subhanallah. وَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَكْذِبُ. And then on the other hand, people lie. And they keep lying until they are written in their books, the liar. وَلَيَّذُ بِاللَّهِ. Notice? Okay. Now, these things then, now, it means what? When you keep saying the truth, what does that mean? This is an institution of building the self. This is an institution of building the character. This is an institution of growing yourself just like a tree. I always say, again, a human being is like a tree. You put water, you need air, you need sun, and this tree grows. Subhanallah. Now, I remind you with what Al-Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jailani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda'ah mentioned 1,000 years ago, and this narration is also mentioned by others, that الدُّنْيَا مَزْرَعَةُ الْآخِرَةِ. Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jailani says that the dunya, this life, is like the farm of the akhirah. Well, if you have a farm, what do? With the farm? You plant it, you have seeds, you have trees. What do you do to the trees? Do you leave them, abandon them? What will happen to them? They will die. No, you always pour water and you make sure that they are, you take care of them, because this is the farm of your akhirah. Notice? Now. So therefore there's institutions to build yourself until you reach this level of Siddiq. Of course, we're not talking about Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, but we talk about the maqam of Siddiqiyya, which means the maqam of truthfulness. Okay. So therefore, because there is a problem with these things, you look at people, you see this stress and anxiety. Stress and anxiety. And we have been also misfed something wrong, a wrong concept, which Islam negates. Islam does not view that the state of being healthy is the absence of illness. When people are healthy, your absence of illness. No, that's not how it is. Islam views that the state of being healthy is the full, active, emotional, psychological, and physiological state of the self. How is that provable? Very simple. Open in the Quran al-Kareem. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. أو أفمن كان ميتا فأحييناه وجعلنا له نورا يمشي به في الناس كمن هو. Notice the ayah. The ayah says, which means, is he who is dead, is he similar to the one who we have given him life and we have given him nur to walk with people, among people, to guide them to Allah? Which means what? Which means really the state of healthy, it's not, has to, nothing to do with the actual having breathing going on. Actually, it means everything, that you have your soul, you have your spirit, you have your heart, you have your body. All these things include then what we call a human being that is healthy. Subhanallah. And therefore you see Ibn Maktum, the blind Sahabi. The blind Sahabi, would you consider him blind really? He has lost his vision. But his heart has full vision, 100%. And notice, Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu, among the Sahaba, you all know Abdullah ibn Zayd, among the Ansar of the Sahaba, the narration says when he heard that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had passed away, he made sujood. And he said, "Oh Allah, take my vision away so I don't see anyone after your Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." And Allah took his vision away and he died that way. Notice? Do you think he's blind? Absolutely not. Now. So this stress and anxiety that attacks societies and diminishes its return and changes the fabric of society, huh? Introduces diseases. Now you go to WHO, they say 80% of diseases are psychologically driven, this, that. SubhanAllah. And you look in our lives and you see we have stress and anxiety. Al-Quran comes to you and gives you the answer. As always, Al-Quran has the answer for things. And we always keep saying that. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن أعرض عن ذكري فإن له معيشة ضنكا. Whoever avoids my dhikr, Al-Quran mentions, avoiding the dhikr or staying away from the dhikr. Number one, what is dhikr? Al-dhikr, number one, among the names of Al-Quran al-Kareem. Al-Quran al-Kareem, among its names, al-dhikr. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا نحن نزلنا الذكر وإنا له لحافظون. We have revealed this dhikr, Al-Quran, and we will protect it, which is the meaning of the ayah. So among the meaning of a dhikr is Al-Quran. Also, among the meaning of a dhikr is what? وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Notice Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A dhikr, when you mention Allah, subhanallah. And as the ayah, look in this ayah of the Quran. Bismillah. اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. كثيرا means a lot. Notice. When Allah told us about salah, أقيموا الصلاة. Not كثيرا. أقيموا الصلاة. آتوا الزكاة كثيرا. لا. آتوا الزكاة. صيام. صيام. وأن تصوموا خير لكم. طيب. حج. ولله يعني ناس حج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا. One time. Fine. When it comes to dhikr, Allah says, اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. Not only that, وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا. Allahu Akbar. Why is this dhikr? Yani this is here, we have to, dhikr كثير, a lot here we have to do. Why? It turns that there's a secret because people are away from the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the dhikr of Allah is what would lead them to Jannah. Huh? Our heart, Imam Ibn Atta Allah al-Sakandari, notice this, Imam Ibn Atta Allah al-Sakandari was the student of Abu al-Abbas al-Mursi, radiyallahu anhu. Abu al-Abbas al-Mursi was a student of Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili, radiyallahu anhum, ajma'in. Abu al-Abbas al-Mursi used to say, if I don't see, he used to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once every day. He says, if I don't see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once a day, I would not consider myself with full iman. This is his student, Ibn Atta'Allah. He says, نفسك, yourself, إن لم تشغلها بالحق, شغلتك بالباطل. If you don't occupy yourself with the حق, what will it occupy you with? باطل. Huh? باطل. Notice, you all know. People, singers, those who sing all the time. I'm not saying again, we're not going into the fiqh issue of singing, but we're talking about those who memorize songs. What happens to them when they're driving on their own? Singing. Voluntarily, no? But, huh? Very casually, he is walking by himself to the shopping, he's singing. Singing words, you see people now, you see him. But notice to those who are the dhikr of the memorizers of Quran, what do they do when they're walking? When they are busy with the saying, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad, what are they doing? They're doing in tasbih and tahleel and subhanallah. Notice the people, casually things come to your mouth. Casually comes, things run onto your tongue. Why is that? Because yourself is just like a bag. And a bag can only fit one thing. You either fit it with right or you fit it with wrong. As simple as that. Just like the plant. And therefore, biologists, what do they say? Most of you who have taken 101 biology, what do they say, biologists? A human being, a product of his environment. Subhanallah. You are in the environment of Quran, you go and everything about you is Quran. You are in the environment of other things, then you are about other things. Simple as that. And therefore, this is the importance of dhikr. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ. We have to do dhikr, a lot of dhikr. How much we do dhikr every single day? Question. We move on. Among the other things of dhikr also, al-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, among his names, al-dhikr as well. Subhanallah. Al-Quran u-dhikr. And The dhikr of Allah is dhikr, and the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the dhikr for Surah Talaq, inna arsalna ilaykum rasulan dhikran rasulan afwan dhikran rasulan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to us dhikran dhikr rasulan. Therefore, fas'alu ahla dhikr in kuntum la ta'lamun. Ask the ahl al-dhikr. Al-dhikr huwa al-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. طيب. So many things, but this comes then to dhikr. Where is the dhikr? If it was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the dhikr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hearts? And you all know, let me take you back to the story of this great sahabi who served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And you all know it. The servant of Rasulullah. And the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the man was crying. The man was crying. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam crying. Thawban. His name is Thawban. You all know Thawban. Huh? I give you the event of Thawban a few times. But it's important. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Thawban. Ya Thawban, why are you crying? He says, Ya Rasulullah, when I am far away from you, my heart yearns towards you. I am sitting with my family and my beloved and my kids and my children, but I cannot stay still until I come and see you, Ya Rasulullah. Subhanallah. Thawban, this Ajami slave who was slave, they enslaved him. Yani, people are free. Yeah? Look at this understanding and this vision. Ya Rasulullah, I cannot sit still. Even sitting still, I can't. Knowing that you are here, I have to come see you. He says then, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Thawban, why are you crying? Then you are in front of me. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm not crying about the dunya, because in the dunya I can always be close to you. But I am crying about in the akhirah, when you will be with the prophets and the anbiya and the siddiqeen and the shuhada and salihin, and well will be Thawban. I can't get close to you, Ya Rasulullah. This is what's making me cry. You see, understanding of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Thawban is not worried about Jannah. We talk about Jannah. What do we talk about? Oh, mashallah, Hur'een. Right away, first checklist. Hur'een. Palaces. Beautiful letter. That's all there for you, inshallah. May Allah make us those who gain all these things. Huh? We talk about that you're going to be living without any food is going to come to you. You will be served. Mashallah. And these keywords to Jannah. You know, the keywords to Jannah. What is the keyword if you want to order something? You don't say, excuse me, over there. There's no menu. But you say, Subhanak Allahumma. If you want anything. If you are in Jannah, may Allah make us all among the people of Jannah. Under the banner of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Under the banner of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because it under the banner of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is where Jannah is Jannah. So you want something, what do you say? If you want to eat apples, you want to eat nihari maybe. I don't know if there's maybe there's something better than nihari for Jannah. Or kebab. All these things. Subhanakallah. All you have to say, the order is Subhanakallahumma. As long as you say Subhanakallahumma, everything you wish will be right in front of you. Right in front of you sitting there. Eat, Bismillah. وَتَحْيَتُهُمْ فِيهَا سَلَامُ. When you see other people, you will be sitting with other people and you will be with the circles and you say, yes, inna kunna fi ahlina mushfiqin. We were sitting together in the dunya. Remember when we were sitting in the dunya and we were with this Muhammad bin Yahya and we talked about this? And you remember all these things will come very vividly to you. And this is what happened and this is subhanallah, how we passed this test and we are here. Yatadhakaru, they sit and talk and over there, if you want to be with somebody, you will be with somebody. Oh Allah, I want to be with this person. So all of a sudden, you are in the majlis of that person and talking to him. Subhanak Allahumma wa tahiyyatuhum fiha salam. And their tahiyya as salam. And when you're done, wa akhiru da'wahum an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanallah. The ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us taste this ni'mah. Na'am. So this is a dhikr. Man a'rada an dhikri fa inna lahu ma'ishatan danka. Now, a dhikr, all these things, a dhikr is absent, that is absent in our lives. And therefore the lives are empty. Notice the hadith by Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, that is mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim. مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. an example, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us, an example of he who does dhikr to Allah and they who do not do dhikr to Allah is like the dead and the alive. You are dead? Dead? Dead and alive? Total difference. Subhanallah. Naam. Now let's move on the ayah. Ma'ishatan dhanka. Dhanak means narrow, being very narrow. Everything is narrow. A life that's filled with narrow. Narrowness. What does that mean? Mufassirin have many ideas. Imam al-Tabari, rahimahullah, radhi anhu, al-Qurtubi, al-Razi, and all of them, they mention this is really in the akhirah. In other words, what? Whoever avoids the dhikr of Allah in the dunya, they will have a rough or life filled with hardship in the akhirah. Al-dhanak here in the akhirah. And in the akhirah what? Huh? The one who does good will reap good. The one who does bad will get bad. Huh? No. Others like Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri among the big tabi'een, sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. He says, al-dhanak really the azab of qabr. Al-ayyadu billah. Torture of the graves, subhanallah. Yes, we yes, of course. Alu fir'awal an-naru yu'raduna 'alayha ghudwan wa 'ashiya wa yawma taqumu as-sa'a adkhilu ala fir'aun ashadda al-'adhab. Therefore, this grave that you will go, this alam al-barzakh, I mean grave by alam al-barzakh, because someone says, well, what if someone is burnt? There's no grave. Well, there's alam al-barzakh. Well, if someone is drowned in the ocean, there's alam al-barzakh. In alam al-barzakh, you are living another world. Now, right now, there are three worlds. We are in alam al-dunya, governed by this physics. Physics. That's why you have walls. You can't go through walls. That's why there is time. That there is lifespan for everything fi alam al-dunya. In alam al-barzakh, in this alam al-barzakh, it's totally different. Things, the time and the distances. Fi alam al-akhirah, same thing. That's why you can go from one end to the other end in a split second. Distances and time doesn't mean anything anymore. Some people have a hard time understanding this. But realize, dear brothers and sisters, that the time and place is a creation of Allah Jalla Jalaluh. And this creation also has a lifespan. Time has a lifespan. And place has a lifespan. Naam. Okay. Now, the torture, yes. The first thing you'll be questioned in the grave, you will have whatever your direction is going, you will be going in the grave. All these things remain to you. Does that mean you will have your understanding and capacities in the grave? Absolutely. In alam al-barzakh, you will have your capacities, absolutely, and you will realize. And it will, the records will be brought to you as if you see them in front of your eyes. You remember, subhanallah, remember that day when you said some such about that man. Remember that little thing that you took out of that man wrongly. Right in front of you vividly, and you will remember it as if it was yesterday in front of you. Subhanallah. مَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. Everything is out there. And you remember it, so you can't even deny it. It's brought back to you. Flashbacks. People say, I'm seeing a flashback. There will be a flashback right in front of you with the details that your hands and your feet will testify against you if you deny. If you dare to deny, they will testify right away. Yes, I did it. The feet, oh Allah, I did it. I walked. Tongue, oh Allah, I said. Eyes, oh Allah, I looked. Okay. The rules of the court in the day of judgment is everything has a right to speak. Everybody has the freedom of expression. Now, okay. Now, another meaning of al-dhanak. What is the meaning of al-dhanak? Al-dhanak also, among these scholars, al-Tabari rahimahullah, he mentioned al-dhanak means al-kasibul haram. Al-kasib al-haram, what's kasb haram? Which means rizq haram. Wal-ayyadu billah. We talked about rizq halal the other day. Rizq haram. If your rizq is haram, this is a narrowing for you things. Though you don't see it, but things are becoming narrow for you. Subhanallah. And therefore, what happens? These people who rizq is haram, is their life is always filled with hardships. Filled with things, difficulties, stress, anxiety. He has 15 gas stations. 20. Selling every kind. huh? From all kinds of beer, all kinds of lottery, all kinds of smokes, all kinds of things, huh? And more, we're buying more, huh? Huh? All these things you're accumulating. Why? Because in the absence of accounting, there's no accounting. There's only an accountant here for the taxes. But there's an accountant over there, and the accountant is accounting everything. Huh? And that will all come very vividly then towards the end. Rizq haram. You think you're increasing while you are indeed decreasing. We'll see. Okay. Now, the other kinds of rizq haram is what? Narrowness in the life. Other mufassirin say Ibn Abbas, another says, no, it's actually the evil deed. Bad deed. Al-a'mal as-sayyi'ah. What does that mean? You do bad deed, that's a way for you to be narrow in this life? Yes. Subhanallah. Notice, as if more bad deeds, they would close your vision. Well, we talked about that. ظُلُمَاتٌ بَعْضُهَا فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ. Huh? People talk about ghibah, for example, we mentioned. Oh, this and this and this. Until they do that, and they don't even feel they are doing wrong. Among the very important characteristics of a dhalim, or the oppressor, is what? That they do not see what they do as oppression. This is how evil dhulm is, subhanallah. Dhulm and oppression is so evil and so bad that even the oppressor himself does not see himself oppressing. They always try to what? Rationalize it. Well, the only reason I'm doing this is because they were going to do this to me if I don't. Huh? Rationalization. Huh? Even a dhalim wants to find excuses because a dhulm is not acceptable to human beings, subhanallah. Huh? وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Do not commit fasad in the earth. قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ. Allah says, indeed they are the evil doers. وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. But they don't even feel it. They have lied so much. They have done ghibah so much that ghibah and lying does not mean much to them. It passes without any alarm. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ تَعَالَى. This is the problem. ثُمَّ كَانَ عَقِيبَةَ الَّذِينَ أَسَاءُ السُّوءَ أَنْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ. The problem with this, the ayah goes to tell us that the عَقِبَة, which means the result of those who commit evil deeds, it may result all the way to what? To even belying the ayahs of Allah. Huh? Even why? التَّمَادِي فِي الظُّلُمْ. What does that mean? Doing ظُلُمْ over and over again and not getting punished right away. What does that tell you? Some people will start having doubts. Well, you know, dhulam. How come there is no result? How come I don't see it in my lifetime? Because we're looking at things from a microscope. Where if you look at things from a telescope, you see life differently, right? Everything is different. Depends how far is your vision. If you live long enough like Ibrahim or Noah, you will see things much more different than someone who lived 60, 70 years. But some people, because they have this, وَلَيَذُ بِلَا, doing all these evil deeds, it accumulates on their heart. And what does it do to them? Then, أَنْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ. Amr ibn Sa'd, among the leaders of the armies who killed for Imam Hussein and other people around him, he mentioned what's attributed to him. يَقُولُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَالِقُ جَنَّةٍ وَنَارٍ وَتَعْذِيبٍ وَغَلِّ يَدَيْنِ. They say that Allah is the creator of Jannah and Nar and Ta'zeeb and torture. And فَإِنْ صَدَقُوا فِيمَا يَقُولُونَ فَإِنْ يَتُوبُوا لِلَّهِ مِنْ سَنَتَيْنِ. Though if they were truthful, then I declare my repentance. وَإِنْ كَذَبُوا فُزْنَا بِمُلْكٍ عَظِيمٍ بِدُنْيَا عَظِيمَةٍ وَمُلْكٍ عَقِيمٍ دَائِمَ الْحَجَلَيْنِ. And if they are lying, if they're not right, some people are like that. If them, I'm with them. As long as they are Muslim, I'm Muslim. But you know, I also be on the other side. So if these are right, I will be with them. And these are right, I will be with them. There is no such thing in Islam. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna ad-deena inda Allah. Islam. Haqq and batil, very simple, very equal. Why people would go to such effects? Because of accumulation of dhulm and oppression, so they cannot see the truth. Their eyes are blind and their hearts are blind. Wal-iyadu billah. They don't see. And they're occupied by what? By what they know. And what they know? Imam al-Junayd al-Baghdadi, Sayyid al-Ta'ifatin, he's called Imam al-Junayd, radiyallahu anhu. He said, it's a pity that some people know and don't practice the knowledge they have. Subhanallah. But worse than that is someone who pretends to be pious while drowning in the oceans of ignorance. Right? Right. So this abbanak then could be then doing the evil deeds, wal-ayyadu billah. We don't have much time to continue. Let me just go right to the ayah, continue the ayah. Then who avoids the meaning of the ayah, who avoids the dhikr of Allah, will have a rough kind of life, or a life filled with hardship. وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. Will be assembled in the Day of Judgment, blind. What does that mean? Lost. Lost. Does that mean they don't have their vision? It is blind in the entire sense of the word. Huh? And then now look at the human being, has the courage, knowing that sinful and all these things, wants to argue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ لِمَا حَشَرْتَنِي يَعْمَ وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. Why, O Allah, are you assembling me blind, and I used to have my vision in the dunya? All these things you've done, and now you still have, you want to talk. Huh? This is also a sign of what? Al-Quran, without even telling you this, a sign of dhulm. Why? Because al-dhalim keeps going, doesn't stop. Takes more. And then they want to take, switch the haqq. They make the haqq dhulam. And the dhulam, haqq wal ayyadu billah. So they have the courage to say, oh Allah, why are you? Why? Because la yash'urun. They don't eat. They went to such effects of dhulam that they do not feel that they are committing dhulam. That's why they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say, they're debating, why are you assembling us blind? وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. And I used to have my basar fi dunya. قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. Then the answer will come, it shall be as such, because our ayahs came to you, and you have forgotten about them, and today you shall be forgotten. The meanings. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم خاتم الأنبياء المعتبر صلي اللهم وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى آله أهل الفقه والنظر والعلم والأثر وعلى من بآثاره مقتفى واعتبر. The ayah basically leads to a conclusion, dear brothers and sisters, with this stress and anxiety that overtakes people. Let me just mention one meaning of dhanak, or what we call stress and anxiety, among the scholars who mufassirin, who said that whatever Allah gives you of good, you will find no good in it. What does that mean? You have the money, but there's no barakah in the money. Money is good if you use it right, but there's no barakah in the money. You have children, but there's no barakah in the children. You have houses, but there are no barakah in the houses. You have this, but there's no goodness in these things. You have so many things, but there is no goodness in these things. That's why you see among the people in the old days, one who is eating, the feet of chickens and little old bread is happier than people who live in palaces with the sheep and cows slaughtered for them. There is really no happiness then there. There's a state of helplessness and hopelessness. Notice? And this is what happens. And the ayah is trying to tell us the way for us to alleviate that, the way for us to clear all that dark vision away from us, is to be attached to the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be attached to three things, namely, now we will cover in the khutbah, Al-Qur'an al-Azim, Al-Nabi sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to do that. Just let's, we are here today, let's come out of the khutbah with something practical. We're not, again, most of you know, this is a madrasa, this is not just a khutbah. This is a manhaj, this is a way, this is a maslak, this is an understanding. This is not just to come and Allahu Akbar and then leave. We have to come and do something. Let's try to do something. The dhikr of Allah, we dedicate only 10 minutes every day, dhikr of Allah. 10 minutes. Subhanallah, whatever you want. The best of it would be, of course, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad. Because that would get you closer to the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And if you are close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then doors will be open to you. then things will be open to you. Then whatever happened to you in this dunya, then you don't care, because you are with someone who you love and nothing else matters. Naam? So the problem with many people with the stress and all these things is because their detachment from the beloved sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, that they don't worry about what was the morals of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what was the walk of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how can I make my day busy with the mentioning of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, so until that your bones and that your arteries and that your blood and that your hair and everything that is about you is thinking about Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, then you will understand, then you will live regardless, you will see this coming in and going out, and who cares? Huh? Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad kama sallaita ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim, barak ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama barakta ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim fil alamin innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wal muslimin, أعلي يا مولانا كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه، من أراد بهم غير ذلك فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه. اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا، آتي أنفسنا تقوى.